I would like to begin with the Rambam, Sefer Zmanim, Hilchot Trumot, Chapter 8. Ha'erusin poslin velo ma'achilin. We are now about to start page 68. So the Rambam said, the daughter of a Kohen, who is betrothed to a regular Israel, is disqualified from partaking the Truma, as she is considered like his wife. Although a regular Israelite woman betrothed to a Kohen may partake of Truma by Torah law, the sages decree that she is not to do so, lest she allow other members of her family to partake of Truma, as stated by Ula. So what did Ula say? And that's the place we finished yesterday. We said, והירוסין היא בת כהן ישראל היא פסילה והקניה בהוויה ובת ישראל לכהן היא לא מאכילה משום דאולה. So we explained yesterday the Torah tells us in Leviticus 22 verse 11 the idea of קניין כספו, she is not eating from the truma, it's because the reality is, imagine, she is betrothed to him, they are not married yet, and he gave her, let's say, a glass of wine. So the glass of wine that he is used, right, it's a truma, it's sanctified. And she said to her relatives, can be a brother, sister, whatever, she said, you got to taste this wine. Now this wine is sanctified, it's only for the Kohen. And she can come to do that, which is to give something that designated solely for the Kohen to others. And therefore, the sages put a boundary and said, as long as they're not totally married, can be. And then they said, v'hachiresh. The same apply to the someone who's a deaf mute. So they said, posel ve'no ma'achil. He disqualified, but does not enable her to partake. So they ask, Ibat Kohen, the Israel, he, Pasila, da kanya, but akante de Rabbanan. That was the sages put the decree. Ibat Israel, Kohen, he, lo ma'achil, kinyan kaspo, aber rachmana. Vai, lav bar kinyan. So again, it's all by the rabbinics. More later in 1:13 elaborates on that, but again, the Rambam tells us the daughter of a Kohen who married a deaf-mute Israelite is disqualified from partaking of the Truma due to this marriage, as it is valid by rabbinic ordinance. An Israelite woman married to a deaf-mute Kohen does not partake of Truma, as he has not acquired her by Torah law. And then the Gemara said, Uben Teisha Shanim. So here is a new subject, which is the idea of the intercourse, the relation of a 9-year-old Yavam. So here you're in a category that basically is in a way capable. He's 9 years, but by the same token, he is not in the age of which we call the full adulthood. So here is the discussion. Kasal karatin b'shomeret yavan leven teish av yom echad. So it means that it still doesn't reach that level of relation. So meaning we not, the Mishnah come to teach us, it's not only in yavam gadol, but even yavam katan, as long as he's in a capability, lemail, what the Mishnah meant, ilem nifsal, meaning that daughter of Kohen cannot eat truma. Why? Because he's capable to have relation, and by having relation, as you remember, we discussed many times, part of the acquisition, capability of acquisition, is by having the intercourse. So therefore, that's the kaban between them, create a situation of disqualification for her to eat the truma. So why the Mishnah used the term 9 years and 1 day? קטן, נמי נפסל פסיל. Because even he below the adult age, he's already make her yevama disqualified from eating truma. Ilach ulei gadol nami lomach, gadol nami lomachi. That's the whole idea of kinyan kaspo. It's only zkuka. So if he's not baaleh, he's not maachil. Amar rabbi hacha biyavam menta shni viyom echad abal yevim to askinan. You see, the key word is zaba. So why he is not machi? In the midoraita kanya lei, because biblically speaking, she's already zkuka. Sargala dacha menol midoraita kanya lei, ubiato biyaa. Even Tosfot said, even without intent, eim alochi kamash melan, asu biyad ben teshni yom echad b'maamar gadol. Maamar, as we said many times, it's a form of kiddushin that the sages instituted in the term of Yevamah before they have their intercourse. And if you have this manner of Ma'amar, that it takes place either by having money acquisition or shtar, meaning a contract, so the acquisition manner, it's not biblical. The same manner as it happened by the regular cohabitation, but by rabbinic law, she's considering his wife. That's the Rambam in Hilchot Yibum, chapter 2. So since it's only rabbinic, it's not have the effect of eating truma. So the same apply for 9 years and 1 day that interact with his yevama, because it's only rabbinic and not biblical. So therefore, as far as eating truma, it's not in effect. So the same way as the shomer yevam, the yevam not eating at the truma, the Shulchan Aruch. In Ebenezer 167 said, a minor Yavam aged 9 years and 1 day engaged in intercourse with his Yavama, the intercourse does not fully consummate the Levirate marriage, unlike other cases in a regular Kiddushi. Rather, it is somehow equivalent to an adult betrothed to his Yavama. That's also, as we said, Rambam Hilchot Yibum, also chapter 5. So that's basically the Rashi's view, as you see it also in page 96b, and Tosfot here. So the whole idea of Bi'at Yavam, Katan, meaning 9 years and 1 day, it's only by the rabbinic law. But according to Rashi in Kiddushin 19, it's biblical. So the Ramban, Rabbi Moshe ben Nachman, page 96, bring this contradiction of Rashi between here and the Rashi in Kiddushi 19, and he tried to explain the difference between here and there. Anyway, it's very interesting, Ramban. So, again, what Rashi tells us here is according to the Abaye in the Mishnah, the idea of not ma'achilin, you're not feeds, it's applied to 9 years and 1 day. But this qualification, it's not. So the Gemara said, Amar le Rava yachay. Rava responded to Abaye and he said, if you go by this way, meaning that 9 years and 1 day, it's not feeding the truma, seifa dektane, seifa ben deyo shnei yom echad safek she'eno, which means he is machmir, his stringence, the same as 9. Hashta vadai ben teisha lo ma'achil, which means it's clear that he is not ma'achil, so therefore safek mi baya. For sure not. So if that's the case, so the 9, the case that we said in the last clause of the Braita, it's superfluous. אלא מרבה בבין 9 שנים ויום אחד דענך פסולים קטן, דה פסלה בביעתן, that's making a פסילות, disqualification for the eating of the תשומה, meaning daughter of כהן, וכדתניה, בין 9 שנים ויום אחד גר עמוני ומערבי מצרי ואדומי, קוטי נתין חלל וממזר שבאו לכהנת לביאה וישראלית פסלוה. So the moment that it's ביעתוביה, so if you have all this category, you go for the Ammonite, or Moabite convert, or Egyptian, or Edomite convert, or is either Samaritan, it's called Kuti. It's the one we said several times that Sancheriv, the king of Assyrian king, put them at the end of the era of the first temple in Samaria. And they converted not in a sincere conversion, they were afraid of the lions, and they continued to worship idols. So that's, if you read the book of Kings, the second book of Kings, chapter 17. Also you see the Ramban on Vayikra, on Leviticus chapter 18, verse 25. So it's not a true convert, they're fake. And therefore, the Torah prohibited us to marry them in Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 3. So therefore, if someone have intercourse between Kohen and woman that she's disqualified, the child lost his halal, lost the capability to be a Kohen. So that's one. And then Natin, there's a famous Torah in the book of Yehoshua, Joshua chapter 9, that Joshua made a covenant with them to leave them alone and to let them leave, even they had cheated him, because they pretend that they are not part of the seven nations that we are commanded to expunge. And as a result, it's part of the Lotit Chatenbam, the prohibition in Torah that you should not marry them. So if they have intercourse with Kohen and Leviyahu Israelit, Psalua, so therefore she is no longer can eat from the Truma. And they said, Rashi said, only Din of Pasul applies to 9 years and one day. That's considering Bia, and he make the Psilu, disqualification for her for the Kuna. So the Gemara challenge Rava. V'hami diktanei seifa. We learn, we're going to learn page 69 in regards to all these cases of anusa, mefuta, nesua, tershote. Im enam roim lavo b'Israel, which is mamzer, ger amoni, all this list, moavi, harei lepsulin, this qualified from eating tumah mechad. Derei shana v'psulin maskina. So you don't need to repeat it. So Mar said Reisha Psulei Kaal Seifa Psulei Kuna. So the first part of the Mishnah deal with those unfit to enter the assembly of Israel by marriage, and the last clause, they sing about those who cannot feed for the priesthood. So the question is, why the Mishnah is referring to them separately? So the way that Rav explained to us is that the Mishnah is referring to an unfit 9-year-old is viable. The truth is that there are many Rishonim that goes the other way around. Tosfot and others. Anyway. Gufa. Ben teisha shnim yom echad gira moni umar vimitzri badu mikuti natin vechalal mamzer. All this list that we said earlier. Shebao al kohen levia v'israelit. So they basically, by having this intercourse, they cause her to lose psalua. They cause her to disqualifying her from married into a priesthood and from eating the truma. Rabbi Yossi omer kol shezaro pasul posel, kol she'en zaro pasul ein posel. So the Rabbi Yossi said, one individual, that anyone whose offspring unfit, so it disqualified the woman that whom engaged. So for marry the priesthood, and if not, the other way not. So they said, Rabbi Shimon Gamliel Omer, Kol Sha'ata, meaning Kohen, Nose Bito, which means the daughter allowed the priesthood, Ata Nose Almanato, which means the widow, you can marry the Kohen. Again, we talk about regular Kohen. It's meaning that later we explain. Rashi said, what's the difference between Rabbi Shimon and Rabbi Yossi? V'chol she'ein ata nose bito, which means the daughter prohibited for the kehuna, hi ata nose almanato. So later, on page 69, we elaborate on this concept. Now, so the cause of this sugya is to understand why she is disqualified from tuma and prohibition of the kohanim. The Torah said, Isha zona v'chalala lo yikachu. So in general, it's anyone who cohabited with a person that he is prohibited to her. So here, there is a big discussion, Tosfot and other. There are those who say that the category of Zona is only one who is Zinta Tachat Ba'ala. But anyway, Menan Emile, now we go the daf full of drashot. So they said, how do you know that Bat Kohen that Nivala Lepasula in Nifselet, Amar Avila Marav, Amar Kra, the Torah said in Leviticus 22, Ubat Kohen Tietiye Leish Zar, He Betrumad HaKodashim Lo Tochel, Kevan Shenivala Lepasula, which means Zar, it's someone who is prohibited to her, Psala, he has disqualified her for marrying into the Kehuna. As the literal meaning of the expression, Ishzar is who is excluded. Now, in this Pasuk, you see only a daughter of Kohen. You don't see any notion of Trumat HaKodashim. So later, the Gemara asks, how come? Hai mi bailek de kama rachmana, it's already. We said the Shabbat Kohen the min Saver lezar lo tochol. We already learned the literal meaning that the moment she betrothed or married, so that's automatically nifsalet betruma. Ahim yivishav al beit avia kinuvay melechem avia tochel nafka. So it means why the Torah need to say veshava, that she returned. What does that mean? The return. The return from what she returned. So מי לקרא מהרחמנה ושווה אל בית אביה תוכל מכלל למי קרא לא אכלה. The whole idea of eating, she cannot only by merely fact that she returned. So therefore, the פסוק that said, ובת כהן כתהיה לאיש זר אם בתרומת הקודשים לא תוכל, meaning if woman engage with someone who's disqualified there, that caused her to lose the ability to eat from the truma. So the Gemara said, "Imea he." If you take this drasha from the word veshava, hava min alav aval michal arse. So we know that she cannot eat, but it's only because of the arse. Katav rachmana hai lelav. It's not only arse, but also love. As long as she's married to a zar, she cannot eat. So the Gemara said, "Love me, because zar lo yochal kodesh nafka." So here you see the Tashbetz, Tshuvot Shimon ben Tzemach, I think, Tzedek Tzemach. It's the great rabbi, I think, in Algeria, 14th century. He had a few teshuvot in regards to minhagim, diverse customs. So here he asks a question, how do you go with this chilufei minhagim? So usually you go by the husband, but what do you do with the widows? How are you treated? I'll give you some points here. The Tashbet said one question was asked is about Pesach. What's the question about Pesach? So basically, it was a question that the wife came from the Palma de Mallorca. The husband was from Algeria. And this is the first response that I know that dealing with diverse customs. Mm-hmm. What does that mean? The Torah said in Parshat Ki Teitzeh, I think, Deuteronomy chapter 21, they said, Ki ikach ish isha. Literally speaking, it means that when a man acquires a wife, so the way we portray the text speaks about her become part of his. So the question is, when it's not come to direct biblical law or rabbinic law, when it's come to the community tradition, community customs. So the Mishnah said at the beginning of chapter 4 in Psachim, they said that if someone have a minag to do work at the Erev Pesach, and he is a traveler to a different location, and vice versa, so you place the stringency upon him regardless. Why? Because he is a temporary visitor. But when it's come to a husband and wife, it's much harder. Because here is not just a husband and wife, it's a, and we are very fortunate in our days to see the fulfillment of Hosea. The prophet Hosea said, I think it's in chapter 4, he said, "Venikbetzu kol ha'amim yachdav ki gadol yom Yisrael," which means he prophesied that will be a day that, as we see nowadays, Baruch Hashem, Ashkenazim, Eretz Sfaradim, etc., which is a huge blessing, but it's also presented its own set of problems, which is, how do you treat a situation like that? By whom you go? So the first response is the Tashbetz that I know. And the reason is because the Jews live in a land, in the island of Mallorca. And because it was a persecution, they fled. And they fled to Algeria. And because they fled to Algeria, they integrated with the community there. And Shimon ben Tzemach, ben Tzedek ben Tzemach, he was the rabbi of the community in Algeria. And he was asked a question with this situation of husband and wife. Which way you go, you know? This one he tries and being, this one not, this is... this one it kreplach, this is not, you know, they are not. So he rules basically that you go by the husband, but in general it was not a also a community that temporarily visitors, they move temporarily, permanently to Algeria. So therefore they're already part of the larger community. But here what the Tashbet said is, if she became a widow, so it's all depend upon if they have children or they don't have children. But basically she returned to her parents' house. So she go back to their parents. So the Gemara said, "Lav mi v'kol zar lo yochal kodesh nafka," which means that's included daughter of Kohen that married to a zar. Zar in that sense, anyone who is not part of the priesthood. So therefore, Rashi is very clear. He says, "V'chol zar lo yochal kodesh v'ashtar asar ladach savar deach bat kohen nam mishtay minei hoil v'niset li Yisrael." 68b. So they said, "Ahu mibayle legufei." So Rashi said, "Lezar gamur, aval ach delav zarai yitztrich ubat kohen nestra." So the rejection is that they said that it's necessary to teach the on halacha that someone who is not kohen is prohibited from partaking the truma zar mamash. So the Gemara said trei v'chol zar k'tiv, they said it's written v'chol zar, a common person. So v'akati mibayel ed Rabbi Yossi b'chanina, d'amar Rabbi Yossi b'chanina v'chol zar zarut amarti lecha v'lo aninut. So the idea of the Torah have it second time with the Zahar, which means that teaches this love, this negative commandment for eating the Truma with the daughter of Kohen that married the Zahar. So the Gemara said, no, the Rabbi Yossi Bechalina Mizar v'chol Zahar Nafka. You have here different category. You have one is the Zahar Gamur. You have the second one is Kohen and not the daughter of Israel. And you have then the third one, Zarut ve'lo nidut, and here you see, Ubat Kohen ki tiye le'ish zar b'trumat ha'kodeshim lo tochel, which means that the moment she cohabited with someone who's disqualified, it creates psilut. She's no longer can eat from the truma. Ve'akati mibayelei, that's the fourth one. Lichde tanya, kshehi chozeret, which means after she divorced or became widow, she go back only truma, חוזר לתרומה, ואני חוזר לחזה ושוק. למה רב חיסדא אמר רבינא בר רב שילה, מה יקרא ובת כהן כי תהיה לאיש זר בתרומת הקודשים לא תאכל, which means the moment she marry a zar, לא תאכל במורם מן הקודשים, she may not partake for the portion separate from consecrated offering. So this pasuk cannot be a source of that halakha. She returned to the house of the father. So this truma she can eat, but not chazen shok. The truma, it's not truma dagan. So it can be in general. So here we separate between the two. So they said in Ken, if this is the idea that if she prohibited them any type of truma, make it disqualified. לכתוב קראי בקודשים לא תאכל, מהי בתרומת הקודשים? Why is they use the word בתרומת הקודשים? שמעת מינת תרתי. So number one, if she prohibited with a person who is disqualified, make the truma disqualified. And also if she married to a czar, right, it's not a kohen, and she became widow or divorced. So as far as the eating chazeh v'shok, from the shlamim, she cannot. So because the word bitrumat looks superfluous. So meaning that it is another category of a woman that she allowed to eat the kodashim, but the muram not. And that's applied to kohen at meriza. So said ashkechan kohenet. We understand when it's come to the kohenet. How about Leviya v'Yisraelit menalan? So how about the one is Leviyad or Yisraelit, that also disqualified when someone who's disqualified for them, prohibited to them, how do you know? Kli amar Rabbi Abba amar Rav, bat uvat. The Torah said, daughter, if a priest's daughter, and they said another phrase, and if a priest's daughter. So you see the letter Vav, it looks superfluous, right? So you derive from that Levi and Israeli women are subject to the prohibition as well. How? So they said, Keman, Kirabi Kiva de Darish Vavin. We derive by the view of Rabbi Akiva that he derives halachot from the prefix vav, which means and or but. So here the key is in the Gemara in Sanhedrin, page 51b. So Rabbi Akiva derived, he disputed Rabbi Ishmael, and he hold that any time that use vav, the letter vav, it's for a reason. But the truth is disputation of the Tanaim. So is that limited only to Rabbi Akiva that Doresh Vavin, that he is hold that prefix have the concept of end and but? My response said, Afilu Rabbanan, Afilu Teima Rabbanan, even you go by the Rabbanan, by the rabbis, we do not derive the halachot from the prefix vav. Kulei uvat kra yeterahu. The entire pasuk, if a kohen daughter is superfluous in the verse, so we derive from that the inclusion of Leviit and Israelit is prohibited, may be driven for the entire expression. And it's a full word, and hakol modim, all whole. Ashkechan l'truma l'kuna menala. We understand that when it's applied to truma. But how do you know that she's disqualified, even married to kuna? Atu levi avisrael l'kuna mirabina l'udi l'truma abnot michal truma ninu. Levi avisrael cannot eat truma. Even that when they are not in a state of disqualification, alama lo. Give me a case. Mashkach ala dehaka, achla bishvil bna. She have a son from the Kohen. So therefore, if you have be'ilat psul, that caused them to disqualify from the kuna. And it's not necessarily that this ribui dealing with psulei kuna. So the Gemara said bishvil bna, קל וחומר, מה כהנת בגלושה נפשה אחלה פסילה? לביאה בישראלי זה לא אכלה לה בשביל נעל, לא כל שכן. So therefore, the ribuy of לביאה in ישראלי, you need to make them disqualified for כהונה. So the pasuk teach us that that's applied, disqualification applies also in regards to married to kehuna. So the Gemara said, wait a second, v'hiya notenet, but this provides support for the opposite reasoning. So I explained my book on Rashi. Rashi said here, v'hiya notenet kushiyahi, klomar itztrich leribuyei, דקל וחומר ראו דקלפת מיני איסורה, היא עמידה נותנת לאיסור, נותנת הדין להתיר ולא לאסור. So usually we are נותנת, it's to explain what we said earlier. So Rashi said that we are נותנת is a question. How? So Rashi said that דקל וחומר itself gives us a reason to go the other way around. That the merely fact that the kohenet gufa is a level of kedusha, that's the reason to make disqualified her much easier, bekalut, much more than other levia and israelit. I elaborate much more in the book. Anyway, kohenet de kadish gufa, pasila, hadelo kadish gufa, lo pasila. אלא לכהונה קל וחומר גרושה. מה גרושה שמותרת בתרומה? אסורה לכהונה. זו שאסורה בתרומה אין עוד אין שתהיה פסולה לכהונה. זה כמו עושה, ולכים מזהירים מן הדין. ולכים מזהירים מן הדין. So, do we warn, which means, do we deduce a prohibition through a logical derivation? Said, גילוי מילטה באלמה היא. It's only a גילוי מילטה, which means, the Kal Vachomer not teaches the warning of negative commandment, marry a Kohen, but it only teaches that if you have a woman that disqualified for Tuma, so she also disqualified for Kehuna, because it's Pgam Bikdushata, because it's the reduction or deficiency of this sanctities that caused her to lose this connectedness to the kuna. The Vilna Gaon in Eben HaEzer 6, it goes a different direction because he hold that that's part of the category of zonah. But anyway, they said ve'eima nivala lepasula chayavei kritot. So you may say that the halacha, if the woman have a cohabitation with a man that unfit for her, applied to those who are liable to receive karet for the act of cohabitation, but not with a man who is unfit to marry in Klal Israel. So the Gemara said, Kiti Amarachmana, the Torah used the word, if a Kohen's daughter be married, Hanach de'idbu havaya, this apply to a valid marriage. Chayavei kritot, those who receive karet for the act of cohabitation, lav bnei havaya, not fit for marriage. Now, the whole idea of Rashi here have a long discussion, how do you derive the whole concept of Chayavei Kritut, how do you derive the whole Kiyye? Anyway, the Aruch Laner elaborates, I wish to have more time, I see we're running late. Okay, Yachr Oved Kochavim Ve'eved Lo Lipaslu. If that's the case, so idol worshiper and slave, Knanat slave, so if they cohabited with her, since they're not Bnei Tfisat Kiddushin, so, and the rule, the halakha is not like that. If you remember, we studied in 62, the Shvul Achayim Poyim Achamor. So, the in Oved Kochavim, it's not considering kiddushin. Asher enough for deshet reu, that's specifically. Anyway, so they said, hanach pasle. מי דרבי ישמעאל? אמר רבי יוחנן משמר רבי ישמעאל, מילן לוחי ועבד, שבעל בת ישראל והכהנת ולוויה שפסלוה, שנאמר, ובת כהן כי תהיה לאלמנה או גרושה. So you derive from that, מי שיש לו אלמנות וגירושין בה, so this פסוק derive if the one who is a potential to what? To widow would and divorce with her, which means someone has the manner of tfisat kiddushin. So that's what you call veshava el beit aviya kinureha milechem aviya tochel, which means that she's not prohibited for tuma because of act of cohabitation. 69, yatsu oved kohavim ve'eved she'enu almanut ve'gerushin. So you go out, the excluded the idol worshiper and Canaanite slave, that the concept of widow and divorce with her, it's not applied because it's not any manner of tfisat kiddushin. That's the Rashi, and Rashi said specifically in that woman. The others go a little different. There is a Rashi in Tractate Chorot 47. Deal with what exactly involved if they have disqualified, for example, Canaanite slave have cohabitation with her. Anyway, Ashkechan Kohenet Levia Israelit Ben Alan. So that's specifically daughter of Kohen that disqualified by intercourse with the idol worshiper or slave. How do you know about others? That they are now, because of this, they lost the ability to because if they are connected to priesthood and the moment they cohabited with idol worshiper, they lost their ability to receive truma. Ki de'amar Rabbi Abba amar Rav bat uvat. So because they add the vav, hachana mei bat uvav keman ki Rabbi Akiva lidarish vavei. Again, we go back to Rabbi Akiva. So only according to him. So they said afilu temar rabbanan, even go by the majority of the chazal should dispute Rabbi Akiva, and they said that we don't derive vavim yeterin kula ubat kra yeterau, entire world, not just the vav, the entire world and a daughter of Kohen. Because if it's enough to say v'chiti almana u'grusha, you don't need to say v'at Kohen. So the whole idea u'bat, it looks superfluous, and that derives also Leviya in Israeli. And that's go by the majority of the sages. V'eima mi sheyesh lo almanut v'gerushin ba, ki leit lezera ka'achala, ki it lezera lo achla. Mi sheyesh lo almanut v'gerushin ba, agav di it lezera nami tichol. So the whole idea of tfisat kiddushin, it's regardless if a regular person that is befitting for tfisat kiddushin. But how do you know that you go stringency, which is someone who is cohibited to someone who is not bar kiddushin, she's disqualified from eating truma by merely fact that they are cohibited, even without having children? Maybe it go by lenient way, which means that if she cohibited with someone who is not bar kiddushin, she's not total disqualified. In ken rabuyei leviya v'israelit lamali. So if that's the case, why do I need to include a leviya, a Levite, an Israelite woman, if the daughter of Kohen is not disqualified from Tuma because of this intercourse with a idol worshiper or slave? So certainly a leviya or Israelite is not, because you have the pasuk that indicate the inclusion of Leviya in Israelite women proves that the halacha is that it's derived from the stringency and not from leniency. So they said, "Im ken rabuya Leviya Israelit lamali." So they said, "You can since you said that the pasuk meant stringency, so we understand also why we need the ribuy of Levia Israelit, because you cannot derive it independently from the daughter of Kohen, because you think, Rashi said, that the daughter of Kohen have kedusha atzmit, which means that he's independent sanctity. The Maharsha said that when it's come to Leviya and Israelit, it's much easier to make them disqualified versus the daughter of Kohen. Tosfot challenged that. Why you don't go lenient? But anyway, Tosfot said that all this pasuk teaches other things as well. Rabbi Akiva Amar en kidushin tofsim b'chayvei lavin. ומאי כי תהיה לאיש זר. So according to Rabbi Akiva said that any act of betrothal for those who liable for chayvei lavin because they involved with violation. So what does that mean? כי תהיה לאיש זר. If a daughter, Kohen daughters, be, meaning תהיה, to a regular common person, said כי תיבעל, which means that's applied to the, if she engaged of cohabitation with him. So why do I need to, the Torah to mention almana u grusha lamali, if a case of widow or divorce, why we need that? You don't have to, because you can derive indirectly from the others. Why you bring examples like almana and grusha? For example, the Sam Rishonim said that if you have someone that it's just have the Isu Aseh, it's also a Tfisat Kiddushin. So they have to say that you go by the one who hold that Rabbi Akiva's view is that in anything that involved with violation, Isu Ebiya and Tfisat Kiddushin. That's the way the Rashba explained. So the almana leachmir aleha. So the reason that you deal with a widow, it's too stringent with her. So Rashi tells us, klomar lav lemeute mishei yesh lo almanut vegerushina legufei tzterich. So the bat kohen kiti almana ugrusha, we thought that it's only a married. But someone who's married, for example, to a slave, it's not having issue of psilut bekeuna. But the way that Rashi understand here is according to Rabbi Akiva, we don't talk about these cases. But almana ugrusha themselves, almana come to teach us the stringencies, and the grusha come to teach us the leniencies. Anyway. צלעת אותו. הוא גרושה להקל עליה. הוא צריך הדיאש מן אלמנה. אלמנה הוא דחילת לזר על אכלה. משום דחזיה לכהונה. אבל גרושה לא חזיה לכהונה עם אבל גם דלת לזר על אכלה. ויש מן הגרושה. גרושה הוא דחילת לזר על אכלה. משום דלא חזיה לכהונה. אבל אלמנה דחזיה לכהונה עם אבל גם דלת לזר. אני אומר, תאכול צריכה. So therefore we need the פסוק for both. אלמנה גרושה. ואם על נבלה לפסולה אף מחזיר גרושתו. There is a famous statement in the Torah, book of Deuteronomy, chapter 24. Someone divorced his wife, and she went ahead and she married someone else. The moment she did it, for everlasting, the original husband cannot have her back. He can have her back only if she's single, meaning she's not married anyone else. So the moment the Torah used the term, אחרי אשר הוא טמאה, so meaning, maybe in that case, since the original husband was Zar, so you may said that that's applied here. So they said le'ish Zar marachmana, mishaya Zar etzla meikara, meaning someone that never have any heter. La'puke the high, which means a husband that divorced his wife and she marries someone else, the lo Zar etzla meikara. The only time that they are prohibited each other is the moment she marries someone else. Yachei halal de lav zar. Who? So how about the halal? לא לפסול. Because we have halal as part of the list, that the moment they prohibited, they make disqualified. אמר קרא ולא יכל זרעו בעמיו. Leviticus 21. They said, מקיש זרעו, לא. מה הוא פוסל? אף זרעו נמי פוסל. So it means it's not just the person himself, the Kohen Gadol, but also his descendants. ואם אמישת הוויה, the moment that she betrothed to someone who's disqualified, the answer, they said, this disqualification, דומיה the Kohen Gadol באלמנה. Tosfot here. Anyway, so, מה קוראים גדול באלמנה בביאה? אפנמי בביאה. That specifically by the cohabitation. So it means the, if they have מעשה, if they have an action שמוליד זרע, bringing a future generation. So it means the Gemara teach us, if you remember, we studied in page 56b, that if a widow betrothed to a high priest, and then she divorced before she married him, so she is not become halala. Anyway, afai name bebiya veim ad ika vayau biya both. So he said, "Dugma the kohen gadol ba'almana, mal kohen gadol ba'almana bebiya lechuda, afai name bebiya lechuda, even without matter of kiddushin." Rabbi Yossi omer, "Kol shezaro pasul posel, v'kol she'en zaro pasul, ein posel." Rabbi Yossi said, as long that the offspring are also unfit, is disqualified. Anyone is offspring now, not unfit, does not disqualify her. So they ask, Ma'ika mentana, kamal Rabbi Yossi, what's the exactly disputed? Amar Rabbi Yochan mitzri sheni, vadumi sheni ika b'nei. So now we talk about the second generation. So those, the first one prohibited. But the second, meaning the children of the children, which is the third generation, that's a different, because the Torah limited the generation. It's not like Amoni and Moavi, that it's forever. So, ושניהם לא למדוע, אלא מכהן גדול באלמנה. And both of them, we derive from the relationship between a widow and Kohen Gadol. So Tosfot tells us that even in the essence of the halacha, if you have bi'at psulim, disqualified, that cohabited, that you cannot derive from that example of Kohen Gadol and a widows. So you derive it from the pasuk ubat kohen ki tiyeh le'ish zar. But since the pasuk teaches the essence of the din, so we derive from the concept of Kohen Gadol and widows, that they are incorporated with that din. Anyway, so they said, Tana kama sabar ma kohen gadol ba'almana biyato shebiyato ba'avira o posel, avai name posel, Rabbi Yossi sabar ke kohen gadol, ma kohen gadol shezaro pasul u posel, av kol shezaro pasul posel, la'apuke mitzri sheni, de'en zaro pasul, dikhtiv banim asher yibaldu lahem dor shlishi, yavo lahem bikal Hashem, that's Deuteronomy 23. So the third generation, it's accepted. So meaning the second Mitzri that married a second Mitzri, so that's, they can come and be part of the congregation. So meaning, unlike the Zera Kohen Gadol and Almana, Zera Sheni Mitzri, even from a regular Israelite, is fitting even for the Kehuna. There are those who said that this explanation go by the Rabbi Yochanan and not by the Reish Lakish, but that's the way the Rashba and Ritva hold. Also you see it in Tosfot 77, but they, on the Ritva and Kiddushin 75, see it in a different way.
שולוים על החי, השולוים על החי.